Our guest of the afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, will be Congressman John F. Kennedy of Boston, son of the former ambassador to England. Mr. Kennedy has recently returned from an extensive trip to the Middle and Far East.
Congressman, aren't you worried about the revelations of communism and corruption in the executive departments?
Well, I'm certainly worried by the revelation of corruption in the executive department. I think that the stories of communism within the executive branch of the government have more or less died out, and I think that determined efforts have been made to rid the executive branch of the government of the communists, and I think it's been done on the whole.
Don't you think that it rather leaves the Democratic Party in a bad fix to go to the people now and ask re-election? Would you blame the voters if they thought it needs a change of party in the White House in order to clean up?
Well, I don't think that the Democratic Party should win an election unless it does clean up. If it doesn't do it, then I don't think we deserve to win the election. I think that efforts are being made to clean it up, but unless we're successful, then I think that we should lose the election.
Mr. Lindley.
Mr. Kennedy, who, in your opinion, would make the strongest Democratic nominee for the presidency next year?
Well, as I've only heard of one or two men discussed, and as it seems fairly inevitable that if President Truman is a candidate for re-election, he will receive the nomination, I would say that he would be probably the strongest. Now, there's been some talk of General Eisenhower running. I don't know whether General Eisenhower is a Republican or a Democrat, and therefore I would say under the present situation that probably President Truman would be the strongest Democratic candidate, as he has led the party for the last few years.
Do you think President Truman can carry Massachusetts if he gets the nomination again?
Providing we're not in a war, providing we have rid the government, the executive branch, and all parts of the government of corruption, I think that President Truman, if he is the Democratic nominee and nominated by the party, has a good chance to take Massachusetts. He took it before. The Democratic Party has carried Massachusetts now in every presidential election since 1932, and I think Massachusetts is basically a Democratic state, and I think if we do our job and do it right, I think that we have a good chance to carry Massachusetts in 1952.
Now, Mr. Kennedy, when I was in Boston last week, I heard a good deal of talk about you. There are many who thought that you would be the Democratic nominee for the senatorship against Henry Cabot Lodge. Are you going to run?
Well, I'd like to go to the Senate. I'm definitely interested in it. I think most of those of us in the House who came in after the war, some of them have already gone to the Senate, like George Smathers and Nixon and others, and I'm definitely interested in going to the Senate. And I'm seriously considering running. I'm not sure yet what exactly I'm going to do. It's still a year away, but I'm definitely interested in it, and I'm, as I say, seriously considering running, and I should really come to a final decision after the first of the year.
Leave it there. Our time is up. This concludes the latest edition of Meet the Press. Thank you, Congressman Kennedy, for your willingness to meet the press. And now a word about next week's guest.
Good evening, and welcome to another session of Meet the Press. Our guest tonight is Senator-elect John F. Kennedy, whose sensational victory in Massachusetts in the face of General Eisenhower's landslide has brought him to national attention as the most important Democratic figure in New England.
You now represent a minority party. What do you think should be the role of that minority party during the next 4 years? A fighting minority, or what they call the loyal opposition, or cooperative minority? How do you see you and your party in the next 4 years?
Well, I think that we should not do what in some cases the Republicans did was in the last few years, to oppose actions which are basically good merely to set up an argument against us for the future. I think that if the Republicans had not had General Eisenhower, who did not have a legislative record behind him, and had nominated a Republican who had been a member of the House and the Senate, that the Republicans wouldn't have been successful because they opposed actions which proved to be good. Therefore, I think that we should support things that are good, obviously, for the country. It's both good for the country and good politically, and oppose those things which are not good. And I think we'll have plenty of chance to demonstrate our opposition as time goes on. I don't think there's going to be any doubt about that.
Then you are perfectly willing to start out in January as letting the Republicans go right ahead, and you will stand by as a quiet, loyal minority.
No, well, we want, as long as they do what we think is right, of course.
Suppose the Republicans do nothing but good, aren't you going to be in an awful spot?
Well, we'll take that chance.
Well, would you say, for instance, at the beginning, there's Senator Milliken has been called in on the budget. Do you think that this Senator Milliken's background in foreign economic policy and the budget would permit you to sit by and say this is fine?
Not a bit. I believe that if the Republican, who are going to be in positions of influence in the House and Senate, carry on as they have in the last 6 years since I've been there, that the Democrats are going to be reelected in 1956 by a large majority. Now, maybe General Eisenhower will follow a different course, and maybe they will, now that they have the responsibility, will follow a different course. But I'm confident that if they follow the course they followed in the past, that they're going, not going to last very long.
Now, this is pretty early to begin talking about 1956, but do you have a candidate for the presidency for 1956?
I think that it is early, and no one knows what's going to happen in the next 4 years.
Well,
Today, I would certainly say that Governor Stevenson would be my candidate for the presidency. I think he ran a fine campaign. He's easily the leader of the party, and I have no doubt that he's going to stay that way. It's still early to say what's going to happen in 56, but he's in the, I would say, the dominant position.
Senator, when General Eisenhower announced that he was going to Korea, the Democrats said it was just a device to get votes. Now, do you think he can accomplish anything by going to Korea? Do you think he ought to go?
Yes, I think he ought to go, and I think he can accomplish something. I agree with Governor Stevenson that the right address to end the Korean War is not Korea, but Moscow. But there are a number of things which he can do, and I'm sure with his military experience, combined with his civil responsibility now, as president-elect, he can do something about perhaps training or speeding up the training of South Koreans. Perhaps we can use Japanese, which hasn't been done yet, and perhaps we can use nationalist Chinese. So I'm in favor of him going to know the terrain and the problems of our troops. Anyone who's in a responsible position ought to go to Korea.
Thank you, Senator. I'm sorry to interrupt, but our time is up. This concludes the latest edition of Meet the Press.
Now, John Kennedy could have chosen any number of far more lucrative fields. He could have used his background, his name, and his talents to further his own means, but he has chosen politics. And we're grateful for that, because he brings an enormous wisdom and charm to one of the toughest assignments in government. And Hugh Downs, are you going to talk about those tough assignments?
Well, now, what we want from you this morning, Senator Kennedy, is advice and guidance to young people who are thinking of going into politics as a career. We'd like to introduce you to some young people right now who are going to fire questions at you. First of all, these four people are just on the brink of a decision, and two of them have taken the first step, as a matter of fact.
Senator, what aspects of political life do you feel are most rewarding for a person interested in entering politics as a career?
Well, I think that there's a great opportunity for service. And in addition, I think that the decisions of government today, both foreign and domestic decisions, affect the lives of all of us. And if you have any decided opinions about what the United States ought to do, it really gives you an opportunity to carry those decisions into effective action instead of merely having the opportunity which most citizens have of merely either of complaining or of using their energies in a rather distant way. So I would say contact with the center of action, and also a opportunity to be of some service to a state such as Massachusetts, for which you have some affection.
Senator, what is your prediction for the future of women in politics?
Well, I think that women have a great future. First, as an influence in politics, I think that statistics in 1952 and 56 showed that the women were much more inclined to independent voting, and therefore they are going to be increasingly wooed by both parties because they are a swing vote and are not, and this is a generalization, they are not quite as inclined to be devoted through thick and thin to one party, but will move with whatever they think is the best for the country. Now, secondly, I would hope that more women would play a more direct role. There are quite a few women in the Congress. Many came because of the death of their husbands who were congressmen, and then they were elected. But I think that women are going, or at least I would hope, that they would play a more influential role in the Congress. They only have had one, they only have one member of the, one woman now in the United States Senate, Senator Chase, Margaret Chase Smith. So I think there's a great opportunity. They represent a great percentage of the population, and therefore I think that they should have more representation in the Congress and in state governments, and I hope that you will, even though you are a Republican, will fulfill that responsibility, Ms. Davis.
Senator, what do you feel is the single most critical issue facing the Congress at this time?
Well, I think it's the same issue which has been facing us for 10 years, and that's our relations with the Soviet Union and this question of war and peace, and also the question of whether the uncommitted countries, the Middle East, Africa, and Asia, will move to the communist bloc or our own and turn the balance of power for us or against us. And that's obviously the most important issue today and will be during, I think, our lifetime.
Senator, at the present time, there don't seem to be too many clear issues between the two parties, the Republican and Democratic. Would you like to try to clarify some of these issues?
Well, I think that it is true that with President Eisenhower and with prosperity that the and with an acceptance of most of the things that were done during the 30s and the 40s domestically, accepted by both parties, that the parties have come somewhat closer together. But that is a trend which we have seen throughout our history of the parties moving together and then they move away as times change. But there is some difference on many issues of the parties, not as distinct as it was in the 30s, but still on all these questions like minimum wage and social legislation and so on. I think that the position of the Democratic Party is different than that of the Republican Party, even as identified by President Eisenhower.
Senator, would you and Mrs. Kennedy recommend to young people whom you know that they enter politics as a career?
Oh, definitely. I've been in now, Congress is my 11th year, and I hope to stay in as long as the people of Massachusetts will keep me in. I think it's the most rewarding job that there possibly could be, and I hope that anyone who has the opportunity and the good luck to be in it, I hope that they will take advantage of that. I would say it's the number one career for any young man or woman today.
Our guest, ladies and gentlemen, is Senator John Kennedy of Massachusetts, just reelected by a record-breaking vote. In just a moment, Senator Kennedy will meet the press.
Now, Senator Kennedy, if you're ready, sir, we'll start the questions with Mr. Reston.
Senator Kennedy, are you now seeking delegates to the 1960 presidential nominating convention?
I'm not.
Why is it? What is it about the mythology of American politics that make candidates for the presidency not admit that they are candidates?
Well, I think mythology and the Bible has told us that there's a time and place for everything. We just finished a campaign for the Senate. I've been reelected to the Senate. 1960 is 2 years away. It seems to me that for those men who might be candidates, that the appropriate time for them to make a final decision is in 1960. And when they've made a final decision to announce it. But now would be an inappropriate time for a good many reasons. It's 2 years away and a good many things can happen.
Mr. Lindley.
Senator, do you think that the recent election threw any new or additional light on the familiar question whether the country would elect a Catholic to the presidency?
Not with precision, but I do think that there were general indications that the American people judge candidates on their qualities, their talents, character, general ability, and they do not regard a man's religion as either favorable or unfavorable. It doesn't seem to come into it looking across the nation. Catholics won, Catholics lost. Same is true of Protestants and Jews.
You don't feel that being a Catholic is today a serious barrier?
Well, it hasn't been a barrier to me at all, Mr. Lindley.
Well, don't you think it would be in running for the presidency? Do you feel that the
Well, if I became a candidate for the presidency, it would be quite obviously I would not believe it would. But in general, I'll answer your question by saying I don't think a man's religion would be a hindrance. Being a Catholic, I see no evidence. If a man had other qualities which would make him acceptable to the American people, I don't think his religion would bar him.
Senator, you believe that the Supreme Court decisions on integration of the school should be obeyed and enforced.
I do.
Do you not? You favor a strong civil rights program.
Yes.
Do you think that a Democrat who holds that view could hold the southern states in 1916?
I think that he can. And there may be isolated walkouts, but my belief is that the Democratic Party is going to stay united in 1960.
Well, what sort of platform do you think that the North, the West, and the South could agree on?
Well, I don't think that there's any doubt that any president who's elected in 1960 is going to make it clear in advance, and then the convention will make it clear that he's going to execute the laws and defend the Constitution. And there isn't any doubt that the Supreme Court has interpreted the Constitution so as to hold that segregation is unconstitutional, and the chief executive has the obligation to implement that decision. Now, whether somebody walked out or stayed in isn't going to change the facts of life. Anyone who's elected must bear that responsibility. so that I can't really believe that reasonable men can break up over that, because the decision has been made and the responsibility of a chief executive who might be elected in 1960 is quite clear.
The presidential campaign is entering its final 3 weeks, with the issue of foreign policy commanding much attention from both candidates. Senator Kennedy, who is our guest today, will begin this week's activities with a tour of southern and central Ohio. It will be his seventh visit to that pivotal state. Climaxing the week's campaign will be the fourth debate on Friday between Senator Kennedy and Vice President Nixon. Mr. Spivak.
Senator Kennedy, you and Vice President Nixon seem agreed that the United States is today the strongest military power in the world. Now, since he believes also, as you do, that every necessary step must be taken to keep it so, why do you continue to make an issue of our military strength?
Oh, Mr. Spivak, we disagree greatly. He says our prestige has never been higher.
Talking about our military power.
Oh, no, but this all tied up with the prestige. When I use the word prestige, I'm talking about the image of the United States abroad, militarily, economically, politically, socially, scientifically, educationally. I believe in all those areas, our relative position is not satisfactory. We have sufficient momentum because we had an atomic monopoly for a while and a hydrogen monopoly, and we had our great airlift capacity. We have sufficient momentum to carry us through to the present time as a strong military power. But the rate of increase, the rate of military growth, is not in our favor. That's what I disagree with. In fact, we've been living off our fat for the last 3 or 4 years militarily. The Soviet Union made the great breakthrough in space and in missiles, and therefore they are going to be ahead of us in those very decisive weapons of war in the early 60s. What is true in militarily is true economically. Their rate of increase is greater. It's certainly true scientifically. And in the image they give to the world of a country on the make, on the move.
But you agree with him that our military power today is greater than any other power in the world.
I would say,
wait a minute, I said that.
It's
yes,
not a question of agreeing
that.
With him. I do believe that today, October 1960, we are the strongest power in the world. But the point is, when are the curves going to meet? The Soviet Union's relative power has been growing steadily in relation to ours, including its military power, especially in the field of missiles. Now, the point I make is, by 1961, 2, and 3 is the crucial time. Are we going to be ahead then? I'm not sure we are, unless we make a greater effort. We're not going to be, in 1962 and 3, the most powerful country in the world.
No, but, Senator, the point I'm getting at is that he says, just as you say, that you're going to make every effort to stay
yes,
ahead.
Yes, but his whole emphasis in his campaign, and I've read all of his speeches, has been that our power is the highest, our prestige is the highest, we've never had it so good, this administration's influence at the United Nations, and all the rest, that we're at the ascendancy. There is no note of urgency in the messages which Mr. Nixon has been giving the last 2 months. They have been reassuring, and I don't think these are times when we can reassure ourselves that we are stronger, better, that our power and influence is growing. I think that's the basic issue that separates us.
Mr. President, in respect to our difficulties in South Vietnam, does our government once in a while tend to get locked into a policy or an attitude and then finds it difficult to change or to improvise in the field as circumstances may warrant?
Yes, I'm sure it does. But on the other hand, what we're attempting to do in South Vietnam and a good many other countries is very difficult also. I think we sometimes are not patient enough. These events happen, and the world, they're recorded on the television screens and the front page of the papers. We're dealing with a very long, drawn-out struggle in South Vietnam, going back this particular phase of it, 10 years, the previous phase against the French, another nearly 10 years, and then when the Japanese were there. So it's almost 25 years of struggle in Vietnam. We feel that there have to be the adoption of some policies, certain policies, to be successful. We don't want to have a repetition of China, because that was the most damaging event, certainly, that's occurred to us, and perhaps in this century, when that passed into the control of the communists. So I think that what we're attempting to do is to provide support for the people of Vietnam in the struggle, encourage the government to move in the direction that will win and hold that support. That takes some time. That takes some time. I don't think we should make a decision that South Vietnam is lost this week. We're working hard to attempt to influence the situation there so that the struggle
which I think is better than it was 2 years ago. At least it was earlier this summer. We were doing better than we were 2 years ago. We had some hope that we were getting to the end of the tunnel. I think, as I've said, the events of the last 2 months have not helped that struggle. We're anxious to see the situation develop there so that the struggle will be aided.
Mr. President, it has been said by some that this office, President of the United States, is almost unmanageable. How do you feel about it after about 3.5 years?
Well, I think that the problems that we face seem somewhat unmanageable, but that's because the spectrum is so wide. If you realize that 25 years ago, the major problems, and they were, of course, tremendously serious, really the major problems were involved the domestic economy and Western Europe. As now we're involved in Saigon, Laos, the Congo, all through Latin America in the most detailed way, the problems have become almost overwhelming. In addition, we still have a very difficult society here at home to keep moving along. When you think of the number of people that are coming into the labor market every year, we have to find about 35,000 new jobs every week just to almost hold our own. That's why I keep coming back to the tax cut. I think that, and we have a history in the 50s of, particularly at the end, of sluggishness. We had a recession in 58, a recession in 60. We've had a higher rate of unemployment than any country in the West in the last 5 years. I think we have to move ahead in the same way, for example, that the British. It's rather interesting that the British government, which has a conservative party, put its tax cut in effect in 1 month. A larger tax cut that we've been talking about for a year, they put into effect in 1 month. And the fact is, the British economy is now booming, and its unemployment has been cut. I think we can do the same. I use that as only one example of some of the difficulties of managing the affairs of government. This is a big government, big country with wide influences. But I think we are making a good deal of progress. If we look back over our record over the last 18 years, I think we can take some satisfaction in it. Western Europe is still secure. Asia is still secure. Your country's never been more prosperous than it now is. Its gross national product is four times what it was 20 years ago. So I think we can look forward to the 60s with a good deal of hope. But of course, this country and its affairs are not managed in the real sense in the White House. There's 180 million decisions being made which finally manage the country.